Welcome to Talks at GS. I'm Allison Mass, Chairman of the Investment Banking Division. It is my great pleasure to be joined today by my good friend and longtime client, George Roberts. George is co-chairman and co-CEO of KKR, which he co-founded in 1976. George and his co-founder, Henry Kravis, are widely known as pioneers of the private equity industry and have grown KKR into one of the most successful global alternative asset management firms in the world. So, George, thank you so much for being here.
Well, and thank you, Allison. Thanks for inviting me to be part of this. And thank Goldman Sachs for putting this on. I think doing what you're doing to this period of time with these kinds of talks and bringing people in shows real leadership. And thank you for including me.
That's great. So, George, as you've helped lead KKR through these last few months, how does it compare to other moments of crisis you've navigated over the course of your career?
Well, I think, first of all, there's no precedent for what's going on today in terms of the pandemic and what that's created in the world economies that we live in today. So I don't think there's any precedent that you can point to, certainly not in my career. Maybe a precedent you could look for is the period of time my parents grew up, which was during the Depression and World War II, which was obviously, something that affected everybody in the world. So when I look at it, what's today compared to other parts of time, quite frankly, I'm probably calmer now going through this than I was in the past. First of all, KKR is in the best shape we've ever been in terms of where we are in the world and how we're set up. And when we started and we saw this coming in February, we said we're going to focus on three things. And we're going to focus on safety of our people. We're going to focus on our portfolio and investments we have that we're entrusted with by other people's money and our own. And then we're going to be on our front foot and we were going to look for opportunities at this point in time. And I've always found that the way to reduce stress in your life is to focus on things you can control. So those are the three things we really went after. And we worked really, really hard to make sure that we had all the statistics on everybody around the firm and their health. And not only that, but the health on all the portfolio companies that we have, to make sure we were doing the right thing. So okay. Compared to other crises that don't compare to this, in my lifetime, probably the most calm about this one.
You know, we've all been thinking a lot recently about issues of racial equity. And I know you've been focused on this, both on the people side and on the investment side. So on the people side of things, how have you been talking through these tough issues with your employees? And what role do you see companies like KKR and Goldman Sachs playing in that conversation?
Well, first of all, I don't think any firm is playing enough of a role in what we're doing. I think if there are going to be changes that are needed in our society, it's going to come from the private sector and corporate America. So if there's going to be changes, the leaders of those firms, and especially KKR, are going to have to be out front of it. So what Henry Kravis has been doing, he's been having conversations, which we've broadcast both through KKR and externally as well, with Ken Frazier, Ray McGuire, just talking to them about what their experience has been. So the first thing is to have people knowledgeable about what are the issues that we really have in our society. There's no one that's white can really understand what black person goes through in their life and has gone through in it. So we started with the people at KKR who are black. And we divided up the list among the four of us. And we just called and listened. And we tried to understand what their background was and the issues they faced and get suggestions from them about what we can do better as a firm, what we're not doing right, what we could do better, what are the changes that are needed. So this period of time has really just been listening and, quite frankly, reading You know, I'm a student of history, and I've gone back and looked at some of that, especially issues in Black history and issues in our country that we faced during periods of time, certainly in my lifetime. And, you know, I can remember 12 years old when President Eisenhower sent in the federal troops to desegregate the schools in Little Rock, and, you know, Lyndon Johnson with the Civil Rights Acts, and all that we've taken place, you know, in our country for a long period of time. So I think just listening, and then we've got to come up with a plan to address it. But there's no change in organizations that are going to get done unless the leaders of those firms really make this a top priority. And that's what Henry and I have done. And he's taken a really good, great leadership in the conversations he's had.
That's great. Now, on the investment side, speaking of diversity, I know that it's front and center as you think about who makes up the boards of the companies that you invest in. We also have a new policy that we only will take companies public if they have at least one diverse board member. So why do you see this as being so critical to how you think about your investments?
Well, look, I think diversity is a good thing because it brings other people with other backgrounds to think about problems and issues you have. You know, I think Darwin, you know, said it pretty succinctly when he said, it's not the smartest or the strongest that survive, it's the most adaptable. So the gene pool has to grow, and you get the best results from people. So what we did, we started this 2 years ago. There's 50 companies in the U.S. that KKR has a controlling interest on and can make an impact on. And we said every company has to have at least two diverse directors. So about a month ago, we've successfully done that. So we have over 100 diverse directors in the 50 companies we have, plus our own board of directors is diverse and will become more diverse as we go along. But the reason to do it is, one, it's the right thing, and secondly, you get the best results from diverse organizations.
So I want to go back now to 1976, when you, Henry Kravis, who is your first cousin, for those who don't know, and your mentor, Jerry Kohlberg from Bear Stearns, got together to form what would now become KKR. What did you want to accomplish with the business at that time? And did you ever think then that you'd end up pioneering an entirely new industry?
No. Look, we started out with $120,000 of capital, and $100,000 was Jerry's and $10,000 was Henry and mine. So we were just trying to survive. And that's really how we got started. But the basis for starting KKR was really, we wanted to work for ourselves and we wanted to build something that was different. Bear Stearns was great to me. It gave me a lot of opportunities. I met Jerry there. Jerry was my boss and my mentor, and I have nothing but great experiences from that. But we wanted something different to do it. So that's why we jumped off the pier and you know, decided, let's see what that's like.
I want to talk a little bit about your partnership with Henry, which, you know, I've been able to observe for decades. And being a co-CEO can probably have its ups and downs. So what do you think has made it work so well for the two of you over the last 40 plus years?
Well, quite frankly, we haven't had too many downs. We share the same value system. We are first cousins, and our families were close growing up. I think that really matters. You have that history in your family. And I think, look, there's two things that could really screw up the relationship that we have, or among any people, really. And one's ego and the other's economics. So we both root for each other. There's no ego involved. Nobody cares whose idea it is. I root for Henry. He roots for me. We never compete against each other in golf. We always play as partners. And the economic thing's pretty simple. We've just split everything 50-50 from the day that we started. So if you take those two things, issues out of the equation, the relationship becomes actually pretty pretty easy to do. And in order to do it, you've got to move and not listen to any external noise. You just got to be totally focused on making sure that relationship really works.
Well, it's clearly one of the most successful partnerships in the business world. So, before I turn to your investing philosophy, I want to talk for a minute about your philanthropy. And you and Henry have both been leaders in philanthropy. Can you talk about how you focus your time and why, and particularly as it relates to the Roberts Enterprise Development Fund?
My late wife and I had financial ability to do it. We wanted to start something that if we didn't do it, wouldn't get done. I guess the term today is now in business school used as venture philanthropy. So when we looked around the landscape, mainly in California, it became apparent there were a lot of folks that have barriers to work, whether it be substance abuse or incarceration or all of the above, that really wanted to work, but they didn't have a job. And you know, my philosophy has been if jobs and job creation and the opportunity to better yourself in life through work is the foundation of our country and how it's all been built. And if we fail in that, we'll fail as society. So the idea was basically, if you don't have a job, you don't have hope. And if you don't have hope, what do you have? So what we started doing was to help finance and help grow, I guess what now is called social enterprises. They were basically nonprofit businesses that basically hire people with those characteristics. So I'll give you a couple quick statistics. 75% of everybody that goes through the social enterprises that we help have been in jail. Almost all of them have had some kind of, either substance abuse or spousal abuse in what they've done. There are now over 300 social enterprises in the United States that create jobs, and they're jobs that create revenue, and it could be anything from making food products to janitorial services, to pest controls, to providing concessions at ballparks for youth. And the idea there is to get people to transition, if they can, to for-profit organizations. And we've tried to track that population of people, which you can do, I think, for about 18 months or so. And about 80% of everybody that has been through work at a social enterprise, and some of them stay there to work, actually retain a job 18 months later. So success is getting somebody back on their feet, making sure they have health insurance, they have a place to live, and they have above a minimum wage job. And several of these people have gone on to start their own social enterprises and to build their own businesses outside of this. It's not easy. You're dealing with a really tough part of the population that's been passed by, but it's very rewarding. So in the last, I think, 5 years, there's been 25,000 people through these organizations that we've been able to help that have at least have a second chance in what they want to do.
That's phenomenal. So I want to turn to your investing philosophy. And during my talks with Henry, he said that no one in his mind can be a great investor unless they're curious. And that means thinking about how to connect the dots. So I'm actually curious. What do you think have personally been the key to your success as an investor?
Well, first of all, I don't, what Henry said, I agree with, but I don't think anybody can be an interesting person unless they're curious, and realizing what you don't know and going and try to figure out what you want to do with it. So I think I was lucky enough one time during the AT&T to be paired with Wayne Gretzky, who was the other amateur in my foursome. And I asked him, I said, you're probably one of the greatest hockey players ever, but nobody gave you credit for being the fastest skater or the player. What do you attribute your success to? And he said, well, you know, I always skated to where the puck was going. So I think investors have to be a good investor. You have to have enough imagination to realize where the puck might be going, where what does the future look like a little bit, what you do. That's number one. Number two, I think you have to develop a sense of people. You know, it's individuals and that make the difference in a good investment or a bad one, at least in my experience. And getting that right and being able to relate to people and make some judgments on people are far more important than all the financial analysis that young people do today. And I think, quite frankly, and I say this half kiddingly, I think what maybe is not the best is the fact that everybody has computers today, and you know all they have to do is hit one little button and they could change the outcome of everything that was there done there, as opposed to taking a a clean sheet of paper and actually writing down some things and doing the analysis by hand and thinking about what you're doing. And secondly, I think young people are trained today to, get good grades in school and get everything right and make sure they have everything documented. They're not necessarily trained to understand other people and relate to other people and what they do. And they're comfortable doing one and not the other. So I think you need to really develop just a sense of, where the world's going, what the opportunity is, and people, and being able to actually relate to other humans.
Yep. So as I was sheltering in place with my family a few months ago, and I was thinking about what this new normal means for all of us, what I really wanted to know was what someone like George Roberts was thinking at the time. So, like early on, first, in the beginning of the year, how did you approach opportunities early in the pandemic? And then I want to talk a little bit about where you're focused now.
Once we were comfortable that people at KKR and our companies were safe and we had liquidity in all of our companies, we decided to really be on our front foot. So we've had a theme at KKR for some time called Connect the Dots, and where people across all of our businesses and around the world really communicated and talked to each other. And Scott and Joe have done a wonderful job of making that happen. So we said, well, we're going to go after opportunities. And we didn't believe we could buy things really any cheaper, but we did believe we could get some exclusive opportunities to do things because a lot of our competition was, worried about other things. So that's what we've done. And, we've invested $18 billion since February 21st. And it's been across private equity, infrastructure, some in credit. And, we've used our balance sheet and our capital markets to stand behind the debt that we've had to raise to do what we're doing. And it's really been great to see the firm work together. And, whether we have something in Europe that affects what we're looking at in Asia, people are working and talking together. And quite frankly, Europe and Asia has been far busier than the United States in terms of what we've been able to do. So it's been, you really see during this period of time if what you've been talking about really works. And I've got to say that it's been working pretty efficiently for us. And time will tell whether the investments we've made will be good or bad. I'm hopeful they'll be pretty good.
One area that KKR has been on the forefront of is ESG. And you launched what you called at the time your green portfolio program way back in 2008, before a lot of firms were really focused on sustainability at all. So why did you see it as so important at the time? And how has it become more crucial to the future of your business over the years?
Well, really, I give Ken Melman credit for this. Ken was had a good relationship with Fred Krupp for the Environmental Defense Fund. And, you know, they basically came to us and said, and through Ken's relationship, why don't we figure a way to study the companies you have and find out ways for you to improve the environment? And we said, okay, that sounds like a great idea. And we did that with 17 companies and actually audited the results, and they were pretty staggering in terms of the positive things. It was, you know, like little things like Dollar General didn't recycle their cardboard. So we started recycling the cardboard and saved $15 million a year. And I could go on and on about what we found. But, you know, we didn't do that in the past because we didn't know. So bringing in other people who are knowledgeable in this that want to work with you is essential. So we bought a business of social responsibility that helped us with sourcing and what we were doing. And it's sort of grown from that. And Ken's taken great leadership in it, you know, with the support of all of us in the firm. And, it's doing the right things, being a responsible person is not hard. You know, just doing the right things. And, it's good for business, and it's really good for the employees in your firm. You know, everybody wants to feel that they have a purpose in life other than money. And people want to work for firms that do the right things from that standpoint. And I can remember I gave a talk at something the Wall Street Journal had put on. And the reporter was very cynical about what we were doing. This was like in 2010. And he said, you know, if this is so great, you know, I went over, he first said, this is greenwashing. I said, well, let me give you the facts. So he backed off that a little bit. He said, well, if this is so great, why are you talking about it? Your competitors are going to copy you. I said, I hope they do. You know, that's why I'm out here talking. I hope they do. And because this is good for the world. And that's how it's grown really since 2008. We just came out with our global impact report recently, and it's really pretty good. I think it's the kind of thing that people that work for KKR are going to feel good about working for KKR.
All right, so my last question for you is, what advice would you have for someone starting out in investing today that you wish someone had given you when you first started in your career?
Well, I was really lucky. I met a guy like Jerry Colbert, and he was a man of principle, integrity, patience. And he gave me a lot of latitude. And I've never forgotten this in terms of how to treat others within KKR. And when I did something good, I got all the credit. And when I did something that wasn't so good, he took the responsibility to help me. So I would encourage somebody to find somebody like a Jerry Colbert that would really take an interest in them as a person. And would be able to help them. I think to me, when I look back, in my career and my life, I would say that was a major inflection point for me. And I don't know where I would have come out had I not met Jerry. I'm sure done okay, but I think that really influenced me a lot, and really how Jerry led his personal life too. And how he raised his kids, and in many cases, what he did wrong. And you know, you learn a lot from what other people do that not necessarily right. So, I'd find somebody that you respect and wants to really take an interest in you.
That's great advice. Thank you so much, George. This was a fascinating talk, and really enjoyed getting your perspectives on the investment landscape.
Well, thank you, Allison, and I look forward to seeing you when everybody can get out of their house or wherever we are and start to socialize again.
Yeah, I look forward to that too. Thanks, George.
Thank you.